Today on Adorama Live on No Film School, we talk compression versus resolution in your cinematic workflow. First, we'll bring on Dan Duran from Red Digital Cinema to talk about choosing the right red compression, then using large resolutions creatively with Katie Williams, and finally an exciting look at the anamorphic lenses from Atlas with Dan Kanes. This is Adorama Live on No Film School.
Welcome to Adorama Live on No Film School. We are here at the NAB 2019 show floor in Las Vegas. I am your host, Stephen Pierce. You can see all of our shows of Adorama Live on nofilmschool.com, so please go check them all out. Today, we are digging into the cinematic realm of filmmaking, from the engineering side all the way through the creative. And later in the show, I'm super excited to get to share with you a new cinematic tool that I've just discovered at our Atlas Lens Company. They make new anamorphic lenses. But first, I want to look at a company that is synonymous with cinema, Red. Great opportunity to shoot on many different models of Red cameras with many owner operators and DPs that prefer Red. One thing that always seems to come up every time we are shooting is which compression to choose whenever you're shooting. It seems like to me that the baseline for everybody is to just pick the highest resolution they can at the least amount of compression, which is not the most optimal workflow. Red's put a lot of work and effort and time into making these amazing compressions. So to join me today is Dan Duran. He's a Red workflow and post-production specialist, and we are going to look at when to choose the what compression, right, Dan?
Yeah. We'll go over exactly. We'll go over what situations you want to shoot different Red coat compressions and how to best take advantage of the camera.
Right, exactly. And just for reference here, we have the Helium hanging out here, the Helium AK.
I think
right?
One is Monstro AK.
Oh, Monstro. I'm sorry, the Monstro AK. You got distracted. So Dan, yeah, thank you very much for being here. Now, first question for you: what is Red coat RAW?
That's a great question. Red Code RAW is our wavelet-based file format. It's what allows us to record 8K today, and it's what allowed us to record 4K when it first came out. Without our Red Code wavelet compression, you'd only be able to record maybe a minute and a half on our 512 mag of 8K footage, but with it, you record hours. So it really gives you a lot more time on our media because of the way we're working with the files. It's also a RAW-based codec, so you know, very similar to your DSLRs, you're able to go in and change your color temp, your ISO, a lot of those metadata parameters you can change because of Red Code. It's also been used on a lot of movies too, so everything from you know, Guardians of the Galaxy to Stranger Things to whatever. They're all shooting, you know, our Red Code codec.
Right, and you, like you were saying, if you just did uncompressed video or whatever, it would be seconds. You know?
Yeah, yeah. It wouldn't be practical at all. It would be, you know, when we first came with a 4K Red One, you would only record a few seconds onto our CF cards. You know, you'd need a massive, you know, refrigerator size hard drive array to record the amount of data at uncompressed 4K. But because of Red Code back then, we were able to shoot the CF cards because of Red Code, and we were able to record, you know, a lot more data that way.
Yeah, absolutely. So do streaming platforms like the popular ones now, like, you know, Netflix, Amazon, Hulu, do they have compression guidelines, requirements?
Yeah, no, they do have guidelines and requirements. Netflix is a great example. They have a great utility and a hub that you can go to on their website that goes through specific parameters and recommendations they have for each one of our cameras. So I'd highly recommend checking it out.
Great. So say I shoot the same compression in like the 5K Gemini, and then I shoot the, you know, as I do in the 8K Monstro here. Yeah. So 5K in the Gemini, 8K in the Monstro, same compression. What difference am I going to see?
Yeah. Well, you'll see some difference in terms of data rate. If you shoot the same compression ratio and resolution, it's the exact same amount of data. So data rate will stay the exact same. In terms of what you're capturing in your image, it's all based on the sensor. So if you're shooting, you know, 8K Monstro, you might get more a cleaner noise floor, more dynamic range.
Just because of the size of the
sensor.
Yeah,
the size of the sensor and how the sensor is capturing the image. And you know, we even have the Gemini, which shoots low light, so you might get cleaner shadows on terms of that file format when you're shooting Red Code. So in terms of data size, they should be the exact same, but in terms of image, it's all going to be depending on your sensor.
Okay, so that's all the background. Yeah. Now, going to the big question for me and kind of why I'm excited to have you on today. How important is compression ratio?
I think it's really important to understand your compression ratio because you want to understand how to best use the tool. You know, you want to understand how to capture the best image quality without hindering your workflow at all. So, you know, when you're shooting something, say you're shooting and you're going to want to, you know, zoom in or, you know, reposition, you might want to shoot less compression because you're planning on really taking advantage of the resolution, zoom in, do whatever you need to it. But if you're planning on, you know, maybe downsampling, finishing in 2K or 4K, you might not need to shoot low compression. You can shoot higher compression because your deliverables doesn't need to be as high quality and you're going to be downsampling. So it's going through and understanding, you know, what compression ratios you want to do. It depends on your project, depends how you're finishing, but, you know, it's best to take a look and play with it.
Do you prefer more compression or more resolution whenever you're trying to save data rate? So
yeah.
would you drop your resolution or increase your compression at a higher resolution?
No, that's a great question. With codecs, usually the more information you give a codec, the better they perform. So ideally, if you're concerned about data, I would rather shoot higher resolution in camera and drop your compression, then shooting lower resolution in camera and raise your compression. You're usually going to get a better overall image. That being said, like if you're like planning on zooming in or doing any repositioning, you might want to shoot less compression to have that flexibility. But if you're planning on finishing in like HD, you might be able to get away with higher compression because you're going to go to, you know, HD format and you're going to downsample.
Yeah, that's kind of counterintuitive to what I believe we've ended up making the decisions on set. The reason I'm glad I'm getting to talk to you. So we'd rather do like 8K at say 10:1 versus 5K potentially like 8:1 or 5:1.
Ideally, I would always recommend resolution first and compression next. So pick 8K or 6K depending on which camera. If you're shooting, you know, Gemini, shoot 5K. I would recommend shooting the highest resolution first and then lowering the data rate or Red Code compression to best fit the amount of data you want to record. That's how what I would recommend.
I made a mistake and I forgot to change my compression rate from 13:1, so pretty high, it's pretty compressed, to 5:1, more, you know, not compressed.
Yeah.
What can I expect my footage? Should I panic?
No, you'd actually be surprised. There's been a few shows where they shot really, really high compression and didn't realize they were doing that. To be honest, you probably just noticed maybe less detail on the image. But yeah, you'll be really pleasantly surprised what you can see. That being said, when you actually view the image itself, you can get away with a lot more with Red Code. Like when you're shooting that higher Red Code compression, you're not going to get things like micro blocking or things you would see in other codecs as the wavelet compression. So you can there's a lot more flexibility when using Red Code.
Okay, great. So is there anything else? Anything else you'd like to add? Anything we haven't touched on here?
the biggest thing I can always recommend is really just to test yourself. Really just go through each compression ratio, feel how much data you want to record, feel what works best for you. But the main reason we made Redcode is to make high resolution recording easy. That's the main reason.
Well, Dan Duran, thank you very much for coming in and teaching us about some compression, man.
No problem. Thank you, guys.
My next guest, Katie Williams, is a cinematographer based out of LA that's originally from South Carolina. Working both commercially and in music videos, as well as in narratives, Katie has the ability to think outside the box and creatively whenever she chooses the resolution she captures her raw footage in. Please welcome to the stage my guest, director of photography, Katie Williams. Katie, thank you very much for coming in.
It's good to be here. I think I did that right.
Yeah, you did. Hey, you worked a mic just how I know to work it.
Perfect. Maybe I got a little bit of sound from my twin.
So, Katie, how did you get started as a DP?
Well, I went to film school, but I would try out for the DP positions just because I thought it was a cool position. But I would never get them. I mean, I don't blame anybody because I wasn't very good. So it wasn't until I moved out to Los Angeles, kind of got on some sets and was like, hey, I'm a DP. Some people would let me do a project, which, you know, they got what it was.
You weren't very good then, maybe, but I was like, but your reel is great. Like,
yes. It takes some years. But what really kind of set my career was investing in equipment. That way I could sell myself as a DP with a camera.
Right. So you
whether could, that works for everybody, I don't think so, but we all have a different path.
Well, it worked for you. And that it's honestly great to hear that has worked for you, because I do know people that have tried it and it's not been the best path for them, but others that are successful.
Yeah. For me, it definitely worked.
So what kind of project is attractive to you? How do you choose a project to work on?
Well, the story is always good to start with. Do you like the story? You know, is it a good director? Will you get the crew that you want? What can you bring to it? So it all starts with a story. And then, you know, sometimes it's like, well, I need a project. And if it's at the right time and in your life, then you take on that project and you can learn something. And yeah.
Seems like you shoot a decent amount of music videos. Is that kind of like a niche that you've gotten into more recently, or you're more exiting now and trying to go more narrative?
I like music videos. It's nothing. I mean, I do like narrative. That's priority. But music videos are fun. Consistency. You can have a little more fun with the images.
Right. It gives you a little more latitude where you can kind of put your stamp on it and be like, this is mine, right?
Yeah. I mean, they're fun. They're usually only a day. Just a day of your life. You're not working on days and days.
As opposed to like a narrative feature.
As opposed to even a short.
You just finished your first narrative recently, right?
I did. That
what was the process like for that?
It was a really good process. I had a good time. It was a pretty ideal situation for anybody shooting their first feature because the director is actually here.
Oh, really?
I know, right? A cool person in the audience. But the director was Jay Holman, who is a retired DP working as a director. So to have that kind of security when you're shooting your first feature, like, okay, well, what would you do? Because I know you know what you would do. So that was ideal.
Yeah, and how did you line your script? How did you go about analyzing and developing the look with the director?
Well, since the director did come from a pretty heavy camera background, he already had a lot of it developed. And so when I came in, it was...
just easy to plug in and kind of make it come to life?
I think so, yeah. It was, like I said, an ideal situation.
So you shot a music video recently using kind of a kaleidoscope effect, and that's what I want to specifically talk about, and also red cameras, because you had to choose the correct size of the sensor for the effect, right?
I did, yes.
Let's take a look at the clip so they know what we're talking about, and then we'll talk more about
it. That would make more sense, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You always go with assumptions. Always some who I was shit. Causing obstruction. I'm not so what shit. I'm on my I don't give a fuck shit.
So that's the effect that ultimately we're going to be talking about.
Yes, that's the kaleidoscope right there.
So what happened with it and what is the nature of that effect?
Well, the director had in the lookbook like kaleidoscope. So, of course, all right, well, how am I going to get that? I'm going to do a little funky lens effect. Am I going to do it out of camera, do it in camera? But... there is a Kish lens at Keslo, which is what we used, and that's a kaleidoscope already built in. But the thing with
and it's
me,
it's a back. Is it a back that you put on another lens, or is it like a modded out
house?
It actually
goes in the middle. So there's a lens in front of it. There's a camera behind it. It just kind of adapts from one to the other, and then you get the multiple images.
Oh, interesting. Mm-hmm. That's cool. So what was the process of choosing? You had to tell me about choosing the resolution to shoot in.
For sure. So when I put the lens on its full photo site count at 8K, there was too many like faucets, so the image multiplied more than I wanted, and you couldn't really see what was going on because there was so many little images. But using red, it does have a high enough photo site count where you can go in and window the sensor, and gave me the right angle of view I was looking for.
What did you end up, the resolution? Do you remember which resolution?
It was 4K.
So yeah. You ended up in 4K instead of 6 or 8K.
Right, that was what I was going for.
What was the rest of the video shot in?
8K.
So the rest was 8K, yeah. You chose creatively to go down to 4K for the shot.
I did on these shots, because it was giving me the right angle of view that I was looking for.
Absolutely. So yeah. Do you prefer always, how do you go about choosing your camera package?
Well, there's a perfect camera for every project. With this one, I did need that high photo site count in order to make that work. And also, it's very energetic, so I wanted the camera to be on a Ronin. So it needed to be a small little camera. And then, of course, I threw master primes on it, so there goes the small part of it.
So yeah. That's a very heavy Ronin.
Yeah, made up for it with the camera, I hope.
Yeah.
I don't know, I didn't operate, so...
Well, that if you're going to put master primes on a Ronin and make somebody else do that, I wouldn't operate either.
Right.
I'd
I mean, they
like,
were excited.
That guy. Like, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't think I could operate a Ronin anyways, because it's like...
It's pretty big. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not made for it, but regular operating, that's me.
So, Katie, what's next for you?
What's next? I'm working on a short that should be in the summer. So... developing the look on that, working with the director.
Can you tell what's the style? Like, can you sneak any peeks, like any facts out of it?
The style, well, I can tell you at the moment, I definitely want to shoot on the K35s. I'm a big vintage lens fan.
Very cool.
And I've been waiting on the right project to use those lenses, and I think I finally found it.
Well, Katie, thank you very much for coming today
thank
and being
you.
On the show.
Yes.
It's wonderful to have you.
It was wonderful to be here.
I just discovered Atlas lenses recently, and I'll be the first to admit I'm very, very skeptical of any new lenses. I'm rarely a fan, especially when they're anamorphic. But the little bit of footage I've been able to find out of Atlas is very exciting because they're making new anamorphic lenses, and they kind of have a commercial feel that is more typical of a new age lens, but they haven't quite lost the magic of a vintage anamorphic lens, which is really what I'm after when I use an anamorphic lens. So before we dig into what working with a contemporary anamorphic lens looks like, let's check out what it's like to work with a vintage anamorphic lens.
Of 4x3 sensors are closer to what, you know, or they're what old film, you know, aspect used to be. Now they become popular for the flares, but really it's also the compression of the lenses, the distortion of the lenses that people really like.
When do you shoot anamorphic versus spherical?
The image texture is very different, and the fall off is very different. The bokeh is, you know, the autofocus elements look very different in anamorphic versus spherical. It's perfectly imperfect. It's like there's imperfections that come with anamorphic, especially with the vintage lenses, that you don't get with spherical. I love doing close-ups on the wide lenses. Mm-hmm. It's beautiful structural frame.
The ceiling kind of starts falling apart, and I'd love to see more table and floor.
Back to the 35, right?
I don't know. So. It's going to be a massive shift of perspective, though. Maybe the 50 is better.
Can we do both? Let's do 35, sure. Then to 50.
Well, you think that works, right?
Yeah, I think that works great. All right, here we go. Let's cut.
We actually just now, the close-up of the glass we did on the 100. And it ended up looking beautiful, and it did what it needed to do, and we were able to do it quick.
I'm very excited to have on Adorama Live the makers of Atlas Lenses, Dan Kanes from Atlas Lens, as well as Forrest. Forrest, I don't know your last name. What's your last name?
Forrest Schultz.
Forrest Schultz, very nice to meet you, Forrest. So what do you all do at Atlas Lens?
Sure, at Atlas Lens Co., we make classic vintage-style anamorphic lenses with modern engineering.
Which is exactly what I think they look like. So that had to, how on earth did you do that? Because I've seen many like contemporary kind of anamorphic lenses, and they don't have the magic. They have, you know, the commercial feel, like they're nice and they don't blur at the edges. They don't, you know, they're a little easier to work with, but they don't have the magic still of the skin tone and everything. It seems like you guys do.
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. I would say that...
Oh, actually, hang on one second. We got to go back and do it one more time. Sorry. We're going back from the top. Sorry. All right, everybody. That was a good rehearsal. We're going one more time. Okay, that's fine. Our mics are on, so just be careful. Don't talk till we tell you. All right, ready?
Need to do, and we were able to do it quick.
I'm very excited for my next guest today. I have the makers of Atlas Lenses here on the show today. We have Dan Kanes, CEO of Atlas Lenses. Correct, Dan? Nice to see you.
Nice
and we
you.
Also have Forrest. Sorry, Forrest, would you mind giving me your last name?
Yeah, Forrest Schultz.
Forrest.
The president.
Oh,
and,
president.
Lead designer.
All right, lead designer. All right, so tell me, what is Atlas Lenses?
Sure, Atlas Lens Co. is a startup lens manufacturer, and we focus on making affordable, high-quality, classic-style anamorphic lenses using modern engineering techniques.
Which is exactly, basically, what I think I'm seeing in it, right? Which is kind of, it's got that vintage feel, but kind of a more commercial engineering and function. How did you achieve that?
Yeah, it starts from the design phase. So when Forrest and I first started working together, we took about a year to really refine the definition of what the product we wanted to make was. And then we set out to use that design definition in order to execute a product that would be classic style, but using all the modern tools we have available, including computer-aided lens design, all the modern processing tools that we have to polish the glass and refine it. And so, you know, knowing what kind of aberrations we wanted a little bit of spherical aberration, minimal chromatic aberration, low distortion, which is not something that you're going to find in a vintage lens, but something that we wanted to sort of create as a bridge to a modern anamorphic lens, and relatively flat field curvature, so you'd be able to hold two actors or a product throughout the frame, left to right, in your frame. And you might have a more difficult time doing that with a vintage anamorphic lens, where the field curves quite a bit through your focus. So the center might be focused at 6 feet, and the sides might be focused at 4 feet, for instance.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's
which can be a creative tool sometimes too.
Of course, that's like one of those fun things about vintage anamorphic lenses. But it is something you have to be ready to work with. Is that something that we can expect out of Atlas Lenses?
What's that?
The curvature where you have like the difficulty keeping.
No, we have low field curvature. So we optimized our lens design to have a relatively low field curvature. So you can have a very flat field. If we're focused on, say, you and Forrest are both 6 feet away from the camera and on opposite ends of the frame, we'd be able to hold both of you in a two shot really smoothly and well.
When we started, we Dan and I wanted to be our first customers. We designed it for ourselves. So it was, in a way, it was a bit of a half selfish, you know, venture that we got into. We wanted to really dream about what is everything that we like, the qualities of anamorphic that get us excited, that we also know that other people get excited about, and some of the features that may or may not be, you know, needed in that look of the lens, such as low distortion that we talked about.
And so, you just happen to be hobbyist glass blowers, so you're just like, yeah, let's just
take a weekend. I mean, we both have a background with DIY anamorphics. So back around the year 2000, I first had identified why I like certain movies, and besides all the great things that you put in front of the camera, the actors, the cinematographer, the lighting, the direction, everything that's going into the movie, all of that comes through the lens as the focal point, no pun intended. But a lot of the movies that I like were filmed with Panavision or other anamorphic lenses, and I thought about a way to recreate that for my still photography at that time, because I didn't have access to any kind of cinema camera. So I started trying to create DIY anamorphic lenses from old projector lenses and making portraits of people that were supposed to look cinematic. And when I first met Forrest, he was doing a very similar thing almost 20 years later, creating his own DIY anamorphic lenses from various parts. And he's really innovative with design and 3D printing. And he actually was creating polishing tools to polish optical resin using 3D printing.
Wow.
And I was blown away by the innovation and the technique, and I said, I'd really love to work with you, and I'm glad I did, because, you know, I'm glad he said yes, because we're working together and we love it.
So do you start with brand new elements, or are you starting with reused elements and rehousing?
We start with design. So we start by first identifying what it is we want the lenses to look like, and then from that definition we start doing computer aided design, modeling the way that the lenses lay up in the system. And so we'll do an entire optical design based on the parameters of what we want it to do, simulate it many times and refine it and refine it and refine it. And then eventually we get to a point where we think we have a perfect optical design for what we want it to do, which in our case allows some spherical aberration, minimized breathing when you're focusing, that flat field and that low distortion, but still have beautiful things like oval bokeh and streak flares that are often some of the hallmarks of the anamorphic look that we like. And then we'll start looking at, okay, is this manufacturable? And then from there we refine it more to be a manufacturable lens design. And then we'll take that model and start 3D modeling it, right, Forrest?
Yeah, I mean, as to answer your question, exactly as Dan said, so it's new glass material, new glass cuts, everything is custom to our design. And that's the way it has to be. As we, after the design phase, as Dan mentioned, we optimize as best we can to keep those characteristics we want, and also to make it manufacturable. We have to make it fit in something, you know,
right,
that's usable. The size has to be, you know, an industry standard. We try to make them all the same front diameter, which we have, the same gear placement for the back and how they work together in conjunction. So
it's not 114 millimeter on the front, is it? What is
these
it?
These are 114 millimeter. Correct.
I mean, they're not super heavy, and the gear, I mean, the turn, I mean, it turns extremely smoothly. It's just, you know,
thank you,
completely different than vintage. I mean, it's like a modern lens, but that's, how did you build back in the vintage look? I mean, was it just in the glass or the elements, or?
We did a lot of, research together. We did a lot of studying. We tried to understand how a lens designer worked back then and realize why you would choose to do certain things and not do other things.
And we chose to embrace the constraints too. So, this is not speaking ill of any other manufacturer. Oftentimes people are seeking perfection, right? And we believe that the secret of anamorphic imaging is the perfect level of imperfection. So we identified the exact point of where we think good imperfection exists in the design, where other engineers might say, this is not perfect enough. We have to limit the stop to a T2.6, or we might have to do something completely different and throw the design away. And we embrace that instead and say, this is, you know, given the limitations of the system, we're pushing it just past that to a place that we're comfortable with.
So On that note, does that mean that their aperture changes and they're going to be optimal apertures for different styles and different looks? And is that universal across the entire line?
That is a truly fantastic question. So I would say across the line of our lenses, if you're looking for something more vintage, you'd probably be at a 2 or a 2.2. And if you're looking for it to crispen up and be more modern, if you go anything past a 2.8, it gets very modern, but not in a negative way, just really, that's clean. where the bridge starts. Yeah, more clean.
A little more sharpness, a little less glow.
Less spherical aberration, yeah. Which is what a lot of people consider glow.
Oh, yeah, got it.
Yeah, exactly.
See, you have the words, I have the feels. You know?
That's why we're here. That's why we're here together.
So
mixing it up.
Tell me, let's just do a quick spec rundown for people that are not familiar with the line. How many model? Focal lengths do they come in, and are they all uniform? This is a 32 millimeter I see opens to 2. Are they all open to 2?
Yeah, they're all T2. We have a 32, a 40, a 50, 65, 80, and 100 millimeter. So there's 6 lenses total right now that are in current production and can be purchased.
2-to-1 anamorphic, I assume.
They're
right?
All 2x yeah. Squeeze ratio. So for anyone out there who's unfamiliar with the concept of the anamorphic squeeze ratio, it's the coefficient between the vertical field of view, which is what the focal length number is, and then your horizontal field of view, if you have a 2x squeeze, is twice as wide or 1/2 the effective focal length. So a 32 is really as wide as a 16. And you know, one thing Forrest modestly forgot to mention is the 7th lens that we just announced today. We haven't announced pricing or delivery dates, but we announced a 25mm T2 anamorphic in the Orion series, and that's a 12.5mm horizontal effective focal length. So
that's
very
amazing.
Wide.
Yeah. That was my next question, is if you were going to open a, like, going to go any wider. I mean, 32 anamorphic's pretty wide, but, you know, that 24 is really impressive.
Yeah. It's over there right now at our booth. It's I didn't mention it because you can't find it anywhere else except here right now. So it's that brand new. We kind of got it ready for this show.
That's fantastic. So let's talk pricing, because that's where this really gets super appealing to me, because a vintage anamorphic lens, or even a modern anamorphic lens, even a faux anamorphic lens with just, like, you know, spherical elements in an anamorphic back, you're talking $35,000-$40,000. I've seen a little bit low used, like in the $20,000 range per lens. Where are you guys at with your series?
Fantastic question. So when we first set out, we identified that for us to be customers of the lens system, we would want lenses that would be about the price of a really good set of spherical lenses. So that could be something like a Canon CNE, Cook Pancro S4 eyes, something like Sigma Cine lenses or a Tokina Vista Primes. Similar pricing to that, but giving us all the anamorphic things that we love. And so for a 6 lens set, it's $49,000 US. And you can pre-order 1 or 6. A single lens is about $8,000, except for the 32, which is $9,000 because it's more expensive to make the glass.
And you don't know where the 14 or the 24 is going to come in yet. That's TBD.
Yeah, we haven't yet set the price or delivery date for the 25 millimeter.
And what's turnaround for, if I wanted to order one of these lenses, what's my typical turnaround look like?
Yeah, it varies depending on the time of year, but right now it's about a 6 to 9 month lead time for a single lens or a set.
So they're made to order?
They are made to order. So at the current time, we don't have any foreseeable inventory that'll be sitting on the shelf. We make a certain number of lenses per year that's based on the demand.
Right.
And then we make a few more after that to kind of pick up, you know, the people that might be tacking on. But we're not quite sure when we'll have shelf inventory, so to speak. So the best thing you could do would be to either rent them from Adorama Rentals or another rental company, or put in your pre-order as soon as you feel comfortable in order to reserve your place in line.
That was my next question. So this is available at Adorama Rentals now in New York?
That's right, yeah.
Oh, interesting. That must be new development. Must have happened relatively recently.
They put in an order pretty early on, and you know, I just saw Steven from Adorama Rentals the other day, and he told me, you guys have so many happy customers at Adorama Rentals for those. So
yeah,
that was heartwarming to hear, and you know, a good sign.
Great. All right. Well, what's next for Atlas? Like, you got the 24. You guys just chilling now. You're on vacation out here in Vegas, or what's going on? What's next?
Well, we're trying to take the show pretty easy, but we do have one more thing that we didn't mention yet, which is the new Atlas Lens Co. LF Extender, and we think this is going to be a really important product for a lot of people, because one of the biggest questions we get every day is, what is the sensor coverage or format coverage of your lenses? And that's a tough question to answer sometimes because they're designed for about a 24 by 18 millimeter 4-perf full height anamorphic film format, which technically no longer exists, but you can find in cameras like the Red Gemini 5K or the Arri Alexa Mini or Arri Alexa 4.3 format. They do cover outside of their design system, so you can use them on stuff like Sony Venice or Red Monstro in 8K 6.5 or 6K 6.5 aspect ratio on those cameras. But people are often confused by those settings. So people are looking for something that will cover edge to edge on all of the large format sensors that are coming out. And this is where the LF extender that we offer comes into play. This works with all of our lenses from the 32 to the 100 millimeter. And it's a 1.6 times extender. So it has two uses. One is it'll allow you to cover edge to edge on all the new larger format sensors that are out and coming out, the ones I just mentioned. And if you're using it with a 35 millimeter format sensor, it'll act as a teleconverter. So you can turn your 100 millimeter into 160 millimeter or your 80 millimeter into a 127 millimeter, which is a really cool and rarely seen focal length in motion picture. I know Arri has the 125 signature prime, which is a beautiful lens. I happen to really like that focal length a lot. And it's a great piece of kit because it'll work with other lenses besides ours. It's optimized for ours. But it'll allow you to cover all those large format sensors and you only lose a 1 1/3 stop of light.
Oh, that's amazing. All right, so one last question, and you may not be able to answer it fully, but here's my question. Is the magic of the vintage in this in the rear element? Because as it opens up, just curious.
Trick question. It's in all of them.
It's in all, I love that.
But I'll let Forrest take that.
No, I can't.
It's really in the cylindrical elements.
I like that answer because
it's a good answer.
It's in all of it. It really is. It truly is. I mean, all of it's a smart design, let's put it that way, but it's very well, we thought it out well, and I think we're holding true to that look. You know, that's the risk that you do, that you take when you're purposely trying to make something where you know there's going to be some residual flaws. Let's call them flaws or aberrations. Aberration is the nicer word for it. We embrace that because we know that that ends up being part of the look. And that's, I think, why people grabbed on so well to it and said, this is beautiful, how did you do this? And it's like, well, we understood where the line was between acceptable aberration and something that you might not want in that lens design.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, in the 1950s, I can't tell you where exactly it is. I think it lives in all of it, to be honest.
It does. Yeah. In the 1950s, lens designers weren't saying, how do we make these have a funky, cool look? They were saying, how do we make the most technically perfect, technically proficient look that we can and save money doing it? And in that, you run into some flaws sometimes because you're in a hurry and you're trying to make it as good as you can for as cheap as you can. And what ended up being some of the flaws of that design are what we now recognize as the things
the
that are the
parts.
Sought after.
Yeah,
just like with music, people really love vintage tube amplifiers or very special guitars and very special instruments. You know, lenses are a cinematographer's instrument and we allow it to be played the way that you want to play it and have that feeling come through, hopefully. And that's really our dream and our passion.
Well, that's amazing. I cannot wait to try it out. And thank you guys very much, Dan, Forrest, for coming on.
Thank you.
Our pleasure. Thanks so much.
Of course. I also want to thank my guest, Katie Williams, for coming on, as well as Dan Duran from Red, for coming in and showing us how to choose compressions on Red cameras. You can see all of the episodes of Adorama Live on nofilmschool.com. So please go check them all out and join the conversation by leaving a comment. I'll see you on the next episode of Adorama Live on No Film School.